So Merlin Carpenter did a show in Coherencia, and he didn't show paintings, but he turned Coherencia into a hangout place, something between a bar or a shrink office. We don't know yet what it would be. And he would open it as a bar, loft, shrink place, where people could just hang out. And this was something very, that also engaged with the community. Suddenly there was a local and friend, a neighbor that became the one behind the bar. Of course, but he was an alcoholic, then we can understand why he wanted to be there. Like, so the neighbors are deeply involved with the project. It can happen that we are putting up a show, and then someone comes in and say, "Hey, do you want to buy this? Like, it's an old coffee machine. Do you want to buy this coffee machine? It's good to make art." Because he knows that artists are appropriating old objects and doing shows with rubbish, you know. They are already into this mood, but we never made a workshop to tell them what we like or what we don't like.
Good morning. I have two questions. First is, can you repeat, André, the title of the article? It's something like, artists must be something that I don't...
Helping themselves. The book is A Certain Lack of Coherence by Jimmy Durham. And I think you can easily get the PDF on the web.
Okay, thank you.
And you can find this article in Mass Effect of the Coherence subway.
And another text that it's very funny in this book. The book is has many interesting texts about cultural politics and minority. And Jimmy Durham is himself a Cherokee artist that quit living in the U.S. for political reasons and lives long in Europe. And one of the texts is an interview with a 10,000-year-old artist, which happened to be a woman, and had to go through lots of problems. She states to be the first artist, but then there was a more famous one. Like it's a funny thing, and it tells about like this is written in the 70s or early 80s, and it tells us that the problems that we as artists go now are the same as artists in the 70s or the 80s or as in 10,000 years ago.
And the second question was about, Tadej, you talk about micro publication and micro edition. Could you please...
I don't listen. Can you speak higher?
Okay. Tadej, you talk about micro publication and micro editing. And I'm very interested in this point. Could you please talk more about that? Thank you.
I mean, it's very simple. Because of my personal interest in printed matter, in books, in different sort of publications, no matter how small they are or how unprofessional they look, we started this program in 2004, and at the same time, this program was in fact idea of support, how to support the production. And we started with a support that means we make an open call and we support 3 to 4 publications yearly. This is what we can afford. And after that, we decide to, because through the years, we exchange these publications with other artists. So, and we decided also to build a collection. So now this collection, it's about 500 books, mostly contemporary production. And we organize also then the seminar for artist book, which brings kind of different artists that they talk about their what they do. We bring some art historians who describe like this brief history of this activity from the late 60s on. We also started to go to book fairs for artist books. So it's a quite a big activity all over the Europe and also the States. And so we just got some invitations, and in, I think, 2005 or 6, been the first time in Paris. And then since that, we are regularly visiting 3 to 4 book fairs per year, because it comes out that these book fairs are important way how you distribute your books. So it comes out that you invest a lot of energy into the production, but then the biggest problem is distribution. Mm-hmm. Because there are, in fact, no one want to distribute this kind of work of art, because it's just not they just don't get enough profit out of it. So this is the way of how you make a distribution. Just go around and then to these book fairs, and also come into contact with different shops which are focus on artists' publications, and we disseminate in this way what the local community produce. Mm. So it becomes a regular program of the gallery, so that we definitely regularly goes to Printed Matter New York Art Book Fair, which is the biggest one, and really brings, I don't know, a couple of hundreds of publishers, but also self-publishers. That means a lot of artists who just do publish by themselves and also distribute by themselves. So it's a really kind of a low-key production. Through the years, it's becoming it's interesting that really intrigue a local artists, and so quite some of them also use this media as a way how to express, and they enjoy it. So I think it was a good idea.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. About that, I think it's very interesting to think how to generate an economy or a microeconomy around an art space, no? Because art economy is between the art market, that is really another world. This is a lot of money. This is not really interested in art, and creation. And the other economy is the institutional economy. It can always be with rules, no? As we know, and with flags, and logotypes, and shields, and this is very difficult to generate this kind of macroeconomy, not only to support the project, but for the artists that collaborate with the project. No? For example, with you, with this friend, Pirata, mm-hmm. He generates a microeconomy. No, but he said the only time.
It was the only time. Yeah,
he spent it fast.
Yeah.
Of course.
When I saw someone in the opening day going down the street with a work under their arm, and I said, "What? Don't hurry, don't hurry. We do more." But all the money went to crack. But actually, just last Saturday, someone entering the space and ask, "Is this are the works?" Yeah,
but
for
it's also a very special show in a way that mm-hmm. looks more sellable.
Yeah,
some of the shows that they don't even look like a show. So for the ones passing by. But something interesting with Pirato is that, of course, is. This is a very thin man, just a little bit older than us, and with a limp. He's very well known in the neighborhood. He and many other junkies. And it's very funny that, not very funny, it's not funny at all. It's very interesting that some of the neighbors started respecting him much more, because they saw the commitment that he had to while putting up the show and mm-hmm. being there every day, and even liked the things that he made. And for example, the lady which runs a restaurant in front of us, which happens to be a very good restaurant in the city, started inviting him to mm-hmm. to eat every day.
But
even
but
nowadays,
this is mm-hmm. there, of course, there's social transformation. Mm-hmm. I'm not expecting to save the world with art mm-hmm. at all. But this made us very, very happy, mm-hmm. and it's also very. You to see how this project can touch contrasts and maybe to be so incoherent at the same time. It's very mm-hmm. Interesting the fact that. The day before of the opening, and the space was already very crowded, we had a visit in our space by Ansel Geschobrist, because he was giving a talk in the museum. So he goes there, he sees the show, he likes, he talks with Pirata. Pirata offers him an
elephant,
an African elephant, one of these that you can buy in the street, but signed. An mm-hmm. appropriation made by the Pirata, signed Pirata. And then the day after, the same day in the talk in the museum, Ansel says to the very big crowd that today I saw an amazing show by Pirata. Mm. The day after, we had hundreds of people in the, the opening because the Pope said, mm-hmm. he saw a great show. At the same, we had lots of course, local artists that were willing to have 15 seconds, not even 15 minutes, but 15 seconds with the pop star curator, and it happened with Pirata, the one that doesn't even care about who the mm-hmm. what the man was, and this is like it's great. It's great that it happens like this, the other way around.
Yeah. Good morning. I have two questions. We don't have an art space here in Madrid, and at the beginning we thought, right, we want this space to be open to everybody, but the thing is that in reality, the only people that come to the space is like art. Well. People close to us or people involved with art life. So I would like to ask you what kind of people attend to your exhibitions, activities, or whatever. And the other question is, when you were talking about working within or out the institutions, you said something like reducing the elements of the system. So could you please talk more about that?
The second question.
Yeah, the second question was when he was talking at the beginning of his talk about working out or within the system. He said something like reducing the elements of the system. Mm-hmm. Yeah, him. I can't pronounce his name.
mm-hmm.
say, reducing elements of the system?
It's something like that.
Okay. Well, it's... this, of course, we could not reduce elements of the system. How can we? Do we have this power at all? We are powerless, more or less.
Well, but elements can be like the creator. He's an element of the system, but we can use it in a different way, or...
I mean, I'm coming from Ljubljana, which is now a 26-year independent state. And before we experience like 40, 50 years of a special version of socialism, and concerning the art system, we never had a proper art system. That means we've been always fighting for the system, because how can you make critics of the system if it does not exist? So we never had a proper contemporary commercial gallery. We never had trained curators, because at that time, when they started to be active in the Museum of Modern Art, there was no such a school. It doesn't exist yet. So they've been all self-trained. So we are all self-made. And also, in the time when I invented the Paris Art Museum of Contemporary Art, I was the only institution in my state that have in its name contemporary. There was no institution, and also some years later, no institution which has the name contemporary in its name. So it's really hard then even to come into the dialogue where there is no ground for that kind of discussion. This is exactly the reason why I established a museum and started to question or comment what we need or what we have to do. And also the opening an artist-run space was in fact to just bring new space for a younger generation who would question the recent economic, social, and political situation. So the system as such was, and it still is completely insufficient. So we always try to build it, and we still did not come to the proper level that we can really attack it. We have now Museum of Contemporary Art, we have Museum of Modern Art, and we have a school for curatorial practices, we are still far from let's say, normal functioning of the world of art.
And the question about the public?
What was the question about the public?
What?
Can you repeat, please?
What kind of people attend to your activities or exhibition? Because at the beginning we thought this is to everybody, but then it's quite difficult to attract like normal people who is not involved in art at all.
And that's the same everywhere. How many people attended to the first punk concerts by Sex Pistols? 20? I don't know. Mm-hmm.
Or how many followers have Marcel Duchamp when he started? or also later. I think on the top 100 perhaps. But it's still, he was experimenting all of the time, and it doesn't matter, you know.
Well, I think that a big difference between a museum or an official institution and a self-organized, alternative, artist-run institution is that the museum theoretically speak for all the people. This is the public is all the people, and that is a fantasy because this is impossible. The society is not so flat. It's not a unity. The society is fragmented. There are very different groups with very different interests, with very different cultural backgrounds. And I think that this kind of space or project, not it's not necessary always a space, speak to a group from a context. We work from a very specific context, and you can speak to a group of artists or for a neighborhood or for someone that has something to do with you. But the question of the public is never been important for me. Sometimes we have a lot of public, sometimes we have nothing of public in different projects, but I think that was very important. What is very important is to find the right dialogue with the people with who can't speak.
Huh? Well, yes, quality.
Not to search a lot of public or to come in the newspapers, but to have this dialogue with the right people.
But it's true that it can be frustrating because as we are the ones opening the shows, like it can happen on a Saturday, and if it's, especially if it's bad weather, that you are there the whole afternoon and no one comes, or comes one person or two, and then you think, why am I doing this? But it's, that's it, things exist. In the opening night, there's always lots of people, well, 30, 40 people. It's amazing. But something that can be a bit frustrating, or sometimes it's when you do a show with someone that is not known in the community, in the town, like there's less people coming. But I also believe that we have managed to, after the years, to have our small group of fans. Maybe we should use the word fans, because mm-hmm. it's really about people engaging in a supportive and for the love, for the cause, for what it is.
And also we have, you know, when someone from abroad, like artists, arrive to Porto, and nowadays with so many people coming into town, we have many people contacting us to see the exhibition, because once they look in what are the art spaces in town, it's, you know, they are not that much, so it's quite, they will come across us. So there are people, because we do visits by appointment, so we have people writing to us or calling us to visit from abroad also.
And we also know that, internet nowadays makes the public wider than we think. Mm-hmm. I don't want to make shows for the photo opportunity, or I don't want to, we never wanted to make a very fast curriculum so that to pretend that we exist. But it's true that people come to know about us through the internet, and we don't know about this. Mm-hmm. 2 years ago, we were contacted by an American curator, young curator, from working in Santa Barbara, and she engaged with the project. And then she was telling us about this exchange series, hardly ever work with us. And suddenly she invites us to produce a little show for a project room in the Santa Barbara Museum. And so, well, are we going to California? Of course we go. And this happened because of the internet, and suddenly we decided to make a very small retrospective of Silvestre Pestana, an art there. Mm-hmm. Which is a kind of incoherencia, because we always thought that our project was highly dependent on our on the relation with the space, and it is. The space frames the gives a context to the shows and to the artist, and makes it justifies the show there, because sometimes we work with artists that have more visibility outside of our space than in our space. So what for to do there? It's like good exercises to challenge yourself. Are we talking too much? Or am I? Mm-hmm.
Well, I have still another question. In the around the year 2000, in North Europe, in Germany and North Europe, started a big discussion about how to democratize, how to open the art institutions. No, this is called finally new institutionalism. This is the first book that is. This is an experiment where several art centers took elements from the artist-run spaces. No? Of course, it didn't work because an institution is an institution. It can work like an alternative art space. But I find it very interesting to think today if we can open a dialogue or a discussion between this kind of activity that we have, I think, in all the cities in Europe, with very different frames, models for ways of work with the institutions, because institutions are always so bad for art. No? I think in Madrid we have Reina Sofía, this is a monster. It's impossible to have a direct relation with Reina Sofía. They are not very interested in Madrid anyway. No? And we have other institutions that deal with different questions, but artistic creation is never on the table. No? And I think that in artist-run spaces or self-organized projects, artistic creation is the first thing on the table. My question is if you are interested or it was possible to have this kind of discussion with the art institutions in your city, in Ljubljana or in Porto. This is something that we want to do in Madrid.
Mm-hmm. Of course, I mean, we have regularly connections and collaborations with different sorts and different models of institutions of bigger and smaller, but it's even the state is asking us to. They are forcing us to have a collaboration with big state institutions, and of course this experience is very bad because the way how they understand collaboration between most important state institution and non-profit center is, I will give you space, and that's it. Mm-hmm. They are not, of course, interested in anything else, because they are the ones who are important, and who knows mm-hmm. how and why and so on. So, my experience is really that the way how they behave is very bureaucratic, and there is no willingness to cooperate in a in a real term. So the collaboration with mid-size or small organization or institutions, however you say, is much better. And we've been a couple of times in different kind of networks of small institutions more or less the same size as we are, although they